एक बार फिर स्वागत है आपका बायोलॉजी क्लास। इसमें आज हम डिस्कस करेंगे सेक्सुअल रिप्रोडक्शन इन फ्लावरिंग प्लांट का सेकेंड पार्ट, दैट इज पॉलिनेशन एंड पोस्ट फर्टिलाइजेशन चेंजेज। व्हाट इज पॉलिनेशन? पॉलिनेशन इज ए प्रोसेस ऑफ ट्रांसफर ऑफ पॉलन ग्रेन्स फ्रॉम एंथर टू द स्टिग्मा of the pistil is called pollination. Kind of pollination. Pollination may be divided into two categories: autogamy or self pollination, allogamy or genogamy, and geitonogamy. Now, what happens in the autogamy? In this type of pollination, pollen grains are transferred from anther to the stigma of same flower of same plant. इसका example है Viola, that is also commonly called Pansy, Oxalis and Commelina. It means autogamy, the pollination is taken between the flower, same flower. Flower will be same, male and female reproductive organ of the same flower is used here. Complete autogamy is rare, it is not very common, and it requires two conditions. The first one is the synchrony in release in pollen grains and stigma respectively. It means the time of the release of pollen grains and the maturity of the stigma will be same. And the second condition, the stigma and anther should be close to each other so that pollen grain easily reach to the stigma. The second one type is geitonogamy. In this type of pollination, the pollen grains are transferred from the flower of one, from one flower to another flower of the same plant. It means the plant is same, but flowers are different. Example, maize, cucurbits, etc. Now, genogamy or allogamy, it is also called cross-pollination. In genogamy, the flowers and the plant both are different. It means the pollination is taken between flower of a plant and the other and the flower of the other plant. The species will be same. Now, agent of pollination. On the basis of agent of pollination, pollination may be categorized in different categories. The first one is the wind pollination, that is also called anemophily. Pollination by wind, example, maize, bottle brush, etc. And the characteristics of wind pollinating plant. Wind pollination requires that pollen grains are light and non-sticky. And the pollen grains should be non-sticky and it will be light so that they may carry from long distances. Numerous pollen grains are produced in wind pollinating plant to ensure pollination. Flowers should be well exposed stamen and large feathery stigma. Wind pollinating plants have single ovule in each ovary. And next character, numerous flowers are packed in a single inflorescence. It is quite common in grasses. The second agent is water, and this type of pollination in which water is used as a pollinating agent is called hydrophily. Pollinating agent is water. Example, it is common in Vallisneria, Hydrilla and sea grasses like Zostera. It is quite rare and is limited to the 30 genera. Most of them are monocot. Remember, all the aquatic plants do not show hydrophily. They may be pollinated by insects. Here I would like to describe two examples of the water pollination. The first one is the Vallisneria. In Vallisneria, Female flower reach to the surface of water with the help of long stalk and receives pollen grains floating on the surface of water. In Vallisneria, female flower will come on the surface of water. And in contrast of this Vallisneria, you can see in the seagrass, the pollen grain, that is ribbon-like structure, is carried out by water current to the female flower, stigma of the female flower. In most of the water pollinating plant, pollen grains are protected from wetting a mucilaginous covering. It means in the aquatic plant, pollen grains are protected by mucilaginous covering. Next topic, insect pollination. Insect pollination is also called entomophily. Majority of flowering plants are pollinated by insects like flies, butterflies, bees, wasps, ants, moths, and other animals like reptiles, inleptiles, lizards are common, birds and mammals like bat, rodent, lemurs, etc. Insect pollinating flowers are large, colorful, fragrant, and rich in nectar to attract the insects. Here, you have to remember the night blooming flowers that are pollinated by insects are white in color, but have good fragrance. Why they are white in color? So that they clearly visible in the night and have good fragrance so that they can attract the insects. To maintain common visit of animals, the flower have to provide floral rewards like nectar and pollen grains. Nectar and pollen grains are called as floral rewards. These are the floral rewards are a type of benefit that is taken by insects, they are given by the plant for the to the insects to attract towards them. The floral rewards are some plant are different. For example, here I would like to mention two types of floral reward. In Amorphophilus plant, which have 6 feet long flower, provide a safe place for laying egg. Any Amorphophilus plant ka jo 6 feet long flower hai, wo insects ke liye एग देने के लिए एक सेफ प्लेस है. इसी तरीके से इन द एका एंड मोथ इंटरेक्शन बिटवीन एका एंड मोथ. एका इज ए प्लांट, मोथ इज ए इंसेक्ट दैट लेज एग इन द लैक्यूल्स ऑफ ओवरी एंड ऑफ द फ्लावर्स. यानी मोथ लेज देयर एग्स इन द लैक्यूल्स ऑफ द एका दैट इज ए सेफ प्लेस फॉर लेइंग एग्स. नाउ नेक्स्ट टॉपिक इज द आउट ब्रीडिंग डिवाइसेस. Outbreeding devices are those devices which ensure the cross-pollination or xenogamy. Why cross-pollination is so important? Continued self-pollination result in breeding depression. Inbreeding repression, any reduction in the crop productivity. So, outbreeding devices are developed by plant to ensure cross-pollination. Flowering plants have developed many devices to discourage self-pollination and encourage cross-pollination. Unisexuality, bearing unisexual flowers, dichogamy, means anther stigma mature at different times. Here, dichogamy may be categorized in two points. One is protandry. In protandry, androecium mature first. In protogyny, gynoecium mature first. It means if androecium mature first, then it is called protandry, and if gynoecium mature first, then it is called protogyny. Now the heterostyly, anther and stigma placed at different position. Usually styles are longer, so that the pollen grains released by shorter stamen unable to reach to the stigma. Self-incompatibility, it means the incompatibility of pollen grains to germinate on the stigma, If pollen grains cannot germinate and have no ability to germinate on the stigma, then no pollination is, no self-pollination is taken place. Outbreeding devices, the next part of the outbreeding devices, artificial hybridization, that is conducted by the human wings, for the crop improvement. Here two practices are adopted, emasculation, bagging. Emasculation, removal of anther from bisexual flowers. In this process, stamen is cut and removed from the plant. Then and another is bagging. The emasculated flower is covered with the protective layer so that unwanted pollen grains cannot fertilize them, pollinate them. Now, the next topic is the pollen-pistil interaction. It is also important, if pollen will not germinate on the stigma, then no pollination will be successful. For the successful pollination, the susceptibility of the stigma is also very important. Now, the development after pollination, there are here some sequences of events after pollination are followed. First of all, entine growth and come out through germ pore as a pollen tube on the stigma. Now, the pollen tube through the style move towards the embryo sac. the pollen generative cell of the pollen tube divides to form two male nuclei, and one male nuclei fuses with the pollen tube enters into the embryo sac, where the two pollen nuclei fuses with separate parts. Next one is the double fertilization. It is an unique phenomena and is common in the flowering plant. It is only common in the flowering plant. It is discovered by S.G. Nawazuddin in the plant Lilium and Fritillaria. What happened in this process, you can see here. The two male gametes that are produced by the generative cell fuse separately in the female gametophyte. One male gamete fuses with egg and forms zygote. This process is called syngamy. And another male nucleus fuses with secondary nuclei or polar nuclei and form primary endosperm nucleus. This process is called triple fusion. What is the significance of double fertilization? Double fertilization very important in flowering plant, because endosperm is a nutritive tissue and primary endosperm that is present in the central cell is converted into primary endosperm cell that form endosperm, and endosperm is a nutritive tissue. It provides nutrition to the developing embryo and ensure the survivorship and increases the chances of survivorship of the embryo. So it is very important. Now post-fertilization changes, that is the first one is the endosperm formation. As you know, after triple fusion, central cell is converted into primary endosperm cell. Primary endosperm cell divide mitotically and form endosperm. The division, on the basis of the division, endosperm formation may be categorized in three groups. The first one is the nuclear, that is more common in the coconut. The second one is the cellular, that is common in the tura and petunia. And the third one is alluvial, that is common in asphodelus. What is the difference between all these three types of endosperm formation? In nuclear endosperm formation, first of all, primary endosperm nucleus undergo free nuclear division and then cell wall formation is taken place. But in cellular endosperm formation, the nuclear division is followed by cell division. Alluvial is the mixed type of both nuclear and cellular. Now the embryo formation. Embryo formation, as you know, in the double fertilization, egg fuses with the male gamete and form zygote. Zygote develops into embryo. It is a post-fertilization chain. Embryo develops from zygote located in the at micropylar end of the embryo sac. The sequence of the formation of embryo is zygote divide to form proembryo, then globular embryo is formed, then Hirschsprung embryo is formed, then mature embryo is formed. The formation of embryo is almost same in monocot and dicot plant. Here the embryo formation in dicot plant is shown. You can see a single cell, it means zygote divide to form two celled embryo, then a multicellular structure is formed, then globular structure, globular embryo is formed, then heart shoe shaped embryo is formed, and finally you can see an embryo that has two prominent cotyledons. Structure of embryo, here the embryo of dicot and monocot are shown in I am going to compare the characteristics of the two embryo. The structure of dicot embryo. The dicot embryo has two prominent parts. The first one is the embryonal axis. The second one is the cotyledon. Embryonal axis. The portion of embryonal axis above the level of cotyledon is called hypocotyle, and it is terminated into plumule. Plumule or stem tip. The portion of the lower portion of the embryonal axis below from the cotyledon is called hypocotyle, which terminates into radicle or root cap. Here I would like to clear, embryonal axis has two parts. Epicotyle, that is upper part, and hypocotyle, that is lower part. The point from where epicotyle and hypocotyle is joined is called cotyledon. Embryonal axis above the cotyledon is called epicotyle. The embryonal axis below the cotyledon is called hypocotyle. Epicotyle terminates into stem tip, epicotyle form stem, hypocotyle form root. What are the main characteristics in the monocot embryo? Monocot embryo, cotyledon is one. And here also embryonal axis is present. The cotyledon in the monocot plant, particularly grasses, is called as scutellum. It means scutellum is cotyledon. Cotyledon is also called scutellum in grass family. The lower end of the embryonal axis, it means the hypocotyle, is differentiated into root. Here also hypocotyle differentiated into stem tips. The hypocotyle and the epicotyle is covered by undifferentiated sheath. The undifferentiated sheath of root is called coleorrhiza, whereas the undifferentiated sheath of the stem apex is called coleoptile. Now the seed. Seed formation. Ovules matures into seed. As you know, ovary matures into fruit. Similarly, the ovules after fertilization matures into seeds. On the basis of presence of endosperm, seed may be of two types, endospermic and non-endospermic seed. The example of endospermic seeds are wheat, maize, barley, castor, sunflower, and the example of non-endospermic seed or non-albuminous seed are pea, groundnut, etc. In endospermic seeds, endosperm is present. In non-endospermic seed, endosperms are not present. Now the fruit ripen ovary is called fruit. or in other way you can say that the ovary after fertilization matures into fruit. Fruit, there are two important parts of a fruit, pericarp and seed. Pericarp is again differentiated into epicarp, outer layer, mesocarp, middle layer, and endocarp, the innermost layer. Fruit may be categorized into three categories, true fruit, false fruit, and parthenocarpic fruit. If fruit only develops from ovary, yani if only ovary forms the fruit, then it is called true fruit. It is more common. False fruit, if fruit is formed from other parts of the ovary, including other parts of the ovary, including ovary, like thalamus, then it is called false fruit. Example, strawberry, cashew nut, apples. Parthenic carpic fruit, these are different from the above two. If fruit develops from ovary without fertilization, remember, without fertilization, then it is called parthenocarpic fruit. Example, banana. Parthenocarpic fruits are seedless. Here I am going to discuss the two definitions. Apomixis. What is apomixis? Apomixis is a type of asexual reproduction in which